I find it a little difficult to say what the subject matter of this seminar is going to be, because it's too fundamental to give it a title. I'm going to talk about what there is. Now, the first thing, though, that we have to do is to get our perspectives with some background about the basic ideas which influence our everyday common sense, our fundamental notions about what life is about. Ideas of the world which are built into the very nature of the language we use and of our ideas of logic and of what makes sense altogether. And these basic ideas I call myth, not using the word myth to mean simply something untrue, but to use the word myth in a more powerful sense. A myth is an image in terms of which we try to make sense of the world. You, as a human being, you grow out of this physical universe in just exactly the same way that an apple grows off an apple tree. So let's say the tree which grows apples is a tree which apples, using apple as a verb. And a world in which human beings arrive is a world that peoples. And so the existence of people is symptomatic of the kind of universe we live in. Just as hair on a head is symptomatic of what's going on in the organism. But we have been brought up not to feel that we belong in the world. So our popular speech reflects it. We say, I came into this world. You didn't. You came out of it. We say, face facts. We talk about encounters with reality, as if it was a head-on meeting of completely alien agencies, and the average person has the sensation that he is a somewhat that exists inside a bag of skin, a center of consciousness, which looks out at this thing, and what the hell's it going to do to me? I recognize you. You kind of look like me, and I've seen myself in a mirror, and you look like you might be people. So maybe you're intelligent. Maybe you can love too. And perhaps you're all right. Some of you are, anyway. You've got the right color of skin, or you have the right religion, or whatever it is, you're okay. But there are all those people over in Asia, Africa, and they may not really be people. When you want to destroy someone, you always define them as unpeople. We have this hostility to the external world because of the superstition, the myth, the absolutely unfounded theory that you yourself exist only inside your skin. Now, I want to propose another idea altogether. Billions of years ago, you were a Big Bang. But now you're a complicated human being. But so we define ourselves as being only that. If you think that you are only inside your skin, you define yourself as one very complicated little curlicue, way out on the edge of that explosion, way out in space and way out in time. And then we cut ourselves off and don't feel that we are still the Big Bang. But you are. Depends how you define yourself. You are actually, if this is the way things started, if there was a Big Bang in the beginning, you're not something that is a result of the Big Bang. You're not something that is a sort of puppet on the end of the process. You are still the process. You are the Big Bang, the original force of the universe, coming on as whoever you are. See, when I meet you, I see not just what you define yourself as, Mr. So-and-so, Miss So-and-so, Mrs. So-and-so, I see every one of you as the primordial energy of the universe coming on at me in this particular way. I know I'm that too. But we've learned to define ourselves as separate from it. What I would call a kind of a basic problem we've got to go through first is to understand that there are no such things as things. That is to say, separate things. That is only a way of talking. If you can understand this, you're going to have no further problems. I once asked a group of high school children, what do you mean by a thing? And first of all, they gave me all sorts of synonyms. They said, it's an object, which is simply another word for a thing. It doesn't tell you anything about what you mean by a thing. Finally, a very smart girl who was in the group said, a thing is a noun. And she was quite right. A noun isn't a part of nature, it's a part of speech. There are no nouns in the physical world. There are no separate things in the physical world either. See, the physical world is wiggly. The clouds, mountains, trees, people are all wiggly. And only when human beings get working at things, they build buildings in straight lines and try and make out that the world isn't really wiggly. But here are we sitting in this room, all built on straight lines, but each one of us is as wiggly as all get out. Now then, when you want to get control of something that wiggles, it's pretty difficult, isn't it? You try and pick up a fish in your hands, and the fish is wiggly and it slips out. What do to get hold of a fish? You use a net. And so the net is the basic thing we have for getting hold of the wiggly world. A net is something regular. And I can number the holes in a net. So holes up, so many holes across. And if I can number these holes, I can count exactly where each wiggle is in terms of a hole in that net. But in order to do that, I've got to break up the wiggle into bits. And I've got to call this a specific bit, and this the next bit of the wiggle, and this the next bit, and this the next bit of the wiggle. And so these bits are things which I mark out in order to talk about the wiggle, in order to measure it, and therefore in order to control it. But in nature, in fact, in the physical world, the wiggle isn't bitted. So the world doesn't come thing. You and I are all as much continuous with the physical universe as a wave is continuous with the ocean. The ocean waves and the universe people. And as the wave, I wave at you and say, you! The world is waving at me with you and saying, hi, I'm here. But the way we feel and sense our existence, being based on a myth that we are made, that we are parts, that we are things, our consciousness has been influenced so that each one of us does not feel that. We feel we have been hypnotized, literally hypnotized, by social convention into feeling and sensing that we exist only inside our skins. That we are not the original bang, but just something out on the end of it. And therefore we are scared stiff. Because my wave is going to disappear. And I'm going to die. And that would be awful. You are a fluke. You are a separate event. And you run from the maternity ward to the crematorium, and that's it, baby. Now, why does anybody think that way? There's no reason to, because it isn't even scientific. It's just a myth. And it's invented by people who wanted to feel a certain way. They want to play a certain game. Camus said there is only really one serious philosophical question, which is whether or not to commit suicide. Should you or not commit suicide? This is a good question. Why go on? And you only go on if the game is worth the candle. Now, the universe has been going on for an incredible long time. And so, really, a satisfactory theory of the universe has to be one that's worth betting on. That's a very, seems to me, absolutely elementary common sense. If you make a theory of the universe which isn't worth betting on, why bother? Just commit suicide. But if you want to go on playing the game, you've got to have an optimal theory for playing the game. If there is any such thing at all as intelligence and love and beauty, well, you found it in other people. In other words, it exists in us as human beings. And as I said, if it is there in us, it is symptomatic of the scheme of things. We are as symptomatic of the scheme of things as the apples are symptomatic of the apple tree or the rose of the rose bush. The earth is not a big rock infested with living organisms any more than your skeleton is bones infested with cells. The earth is geological, yes, but this geological entity grows people. And our existence on the earth is a symptom of the solar system and its balances, as much as the solar system in turn is a symptom of our galaxy. And our galaxy in its turn is a symptom of the whole company of galaxies. Goodness only knows what that's in. When, as a scientist, you describe the behavior of a living organism, you try to say what a person does. It's the only way in which you can describe what a person is. Describe what they do. Then you find out that in making this description, you cannot confine yourself to what happens inside the skin. In other words, you can't talk about a person walking unless you start describing the floor. Because when I walk, I don't just dangle my legs in empty space. I move in relationship to a room. And so in order to describe what I'm doing when I'm walking, I have to describe the room. I have to describe the territory. So describing my talking at the moment, I can't describe this just as a thing in itself because I'm talking to you. And so what I'm doing at the moment is not completely described unless your being here is described also. So if that is necessary, if in other words, in order to describe my behavior, I have to describe your behavior and the behavior of the environment, it means that we've really got one system of behavior. That what I am involves what you are. I don't know who I am unless I know who you are. And you don't know who you are unless you know who I am. In other words, we are not separate. We define each other. We're all backs and fronts to each other. We and our environment, and all of us and each other, are interdependent systems. We know who we are in terms of other people. We all lock together. And this is, again and again, the serious scientific description of how things happen. And any good scientist knows that what you call the external world is as much you as your own body. Your skin doesn't separate you from the world. It's a bridge through which the external world flows into you, and you flow into it. Just, for example, as a whirlpool in water, you could say because you have a skin, you have a definite shape, you have a definite form. The whirlpool is a definite form, but no water stays put in it. The whirlpool is something the stream is doing. And exactly the same way, the whole universe is doing each one of us. And I see you today, and I recognize you tomorrow, just as I would recognize a whirlpool in a stream. I'd say, oh yes, I've seen that whirlpool before. It's just near so-and-so's house on the edge of the river, and it's always there. So in the same way, when I meet you tomorrow, I recognize you, you're the same whirlpool you were yesterday. But you're moving. The whole world is moving through you. All the cosmic rays, all the food you're eating, the stream of steaks and milk and eggs and everything is just flowing right through you. When you're wiggling the same way, the world is wiggling, the stream is wiggling you. But the problem is, you see, we haven't been taught to feel that way. The myths underlying our culture and underlying our common sense have not taught us to feel identical with the universe, but only parts of it, only in it, only confronting it, aliens. And we are, I think, quite urgently in need of coming to feel that we are the eternal universe, each one of us. Otherwise, we're going to go out of our heads. We're going to commit suicide, collectively, courtesy of H-bombs. And, all right, supposing we do, well, that will be that, and it'll be life making experiments on other galaxies. Maybe they'll find a better game. I wonder if it's ever struck you how curious a thing it is that most of the things that we experience, we regard as things that happen to us, which we ourselves do not originate, which are events expressing some sort of power or activity that is external to ourselves. And if you consider that, you realize that what you mean by yourself is rather narrowly circumscribed. Even events that go on in our own bodies are put in the category of things that happen to us in the same way as things that go on in the world outside our skins. If there's a thunderstorm or an earthquake, well, it happens to you. You're not responsible for it. But so in the same way, when you have hiccups, you didn't plan on it. If you have belly rumbles, you had no intention of doing it. And as to the catastrophic act of getting born, well, you had nothing to do with that. And you can spend all your life blaming your parents for putting you in the situation in which you find yourself. And this way of looking at the world in this sort of passive mood as something that happens to you goes right down to our general feeling about life. It goes down to the way in which we have been accustomed to look at human existence as a precarious event in a cosmos that, on the whole, is depicted as being completely unsympathetic and alien to our existence. If you're reared with a 20th century, or shall we say an early 20th century common sense, which is based on the philosophy of science of the 19th century, you regard yourself as an accident, a biological accident, in a stupid universe, which is mechanical, but has no feelings. A vast pointless gyration of radioactive rocks and gas in which you happen to occur. Of course, if you don't have that point of view and you are more traditional, you look upon yourself as a child of God. And therefore, under authority. In other words, there's a big boss on top of all this. And you better watch your P's and Q's, because that Almighty is looking after you with the attitude of, this is going to hurt me more than it's going to hurt you. And when you look at the world in that image, or in the other image, that it's a stupid mechanism, either point of view you take, you don't really belong. You're not really part of all this. Or to put it in the strongest possible way, it is quite alien to our thought that the external world, which is defined as something that happens to you, and your body itself as something that you got caught up with, it is quite alien to consider all that as you yourself. Because, you see, we have such a myopic view of what oneself is. Now, we come here to an extremely important principle, which is the different points of view you get when you change your level of magnification. That is to say, you can look at something with a microscope and see it a certain way. You can look at it with the naked eye and see it in a certain way. You look at it with a telescope and you see it in another way. Now, which level of magnification is the correct one? Well, obviously, they're all correct. They're just different points of view. When we examine our bloodstreams under a microscope, we see there's one hell of a fight going on. All sorts of microorganisms are chewing each other up. And if we got overly fascinated with our view of our own bloodstreams in the microscope, we should start taking sides, which would be fatal. Because the health of our organism depends on the continuance of this battle. What is, in other words, conflict at one level of magnification is harmony at a higher level. Now, could it possibly be, therefore, that we, with all our problems, conflicts, neuroses, sicknesses, political outrages, wars, tortures, and everything that goes on in human life, are a state of conflict which can be seen in a larger perspective as a situation of harmony? And you can say, aha, at last I see, I got the point. I've seen how all this makes sense. But what this insight depended upon was your overcoming the illusion that space separates things. That is to say, the space, the interval between your body and mine, the interval created by birth at one end and death at the other, and then after somebody's death, then somebody else's birth. These are events with intervals between them. And normally we regard these intervals in time and these intervals in space as having no importance, no function. We tend to see the universe itself as really consisting in all the stars and galaxies. That's what it is, that's what we notice. But the space in which all this happens is sort of written off as something that isn't really there. But what one has to realize is that the space is an essential function of the things in the space. After all, you can't have separate stars unless there is a space around them. Eliminate the space and you will see you couldn't have this phenomenon at all. And vice versa. You couldn't have the space. They wouldn't be there in any sense whatsoever if there weren't the bodies in it. So the bodies in the space and the space are two aspects of a single continuum. They're related together in exactly the same way as a back and a front. And you just don't get one without the other. So the moment you see that intervals, that space, is connective, you can understand at once how you are not just to be exclusively defined as a flash of consciousness that occurs between two eternal darknesses, that you consider that in the darkness that comes before your birth, there was no you, and in the eternal darkness that follows your death, there is likewise no you. And I'm going to discuss these matters, not by appealing to any special spooky knowledge, as if I had been traveling on the higher planes and knew all my previous incarnations and therefore could tell you authoritatively that you are much more than this individuality. I'm going to do it on a basis of complete common sense, that everybody has access to the facts. Life is a pattern of immense complexity. And what you call yourself as a living organism, say, I am my whole body at the very least. Now, what is that body? That body is recognizable, and I recognize my friends when I meet them again, and you recognize me. Although the last time any of you saw me, I was absolutely something entirely different from what I am now. Just as the flame of a candle is never a constant. A flame of a candle is a stream of hot gas. Only you say the flame of the candle as if it were a constant. Well, it is a recognizably constant pattern, but in exactly the same way, we are all constant patterns. And that's all we are. The only thing constant about us at all is the doing rather than the being. It's the way we behave, the way we dance. Only there's no we that dances. There's just the dancing. There is no thing that whirlpools. There is the whirlpool, and in the same way, each one of us is a very, very delightfully complex undulation of the energy of the whole universe. Because life is basically a game of hide and seek, because life is pulsation, on and off. Here it is, and now it isn't. And by being this pulsation, we know it's there. Now, from those very tiny fast rhythms, which give us the impression of continuity, there are also in this universe immensely slow rhythms. And these are very difficult for us to keep track of. And they impress us and depress us as our own life and death, as our coming and going, which goes for what is to us such a slow pace that we can't possibly believe that it is really a rhythm. We think of it as our birth, as something quite unique that could never occur again, because we're so close to it, you see, and it's moving so slowly. The process of growth, the basic process of biology is one in which lower orders are always being superseded by higher orders. But the lower order can never figure out, or only very rarely figure out, what the higher order is that's taking over. And may see it as a terrible threat, as total disaster, as the very end. But can never be aware that the principle of growth always has and always will continue, because that's what's going on. But you never know what the next step is going to be, because if you did know, you wouldn't take it, because it would already be past. Do you understand this? That any certainly known future is an event of which we can say, you've had it. And in that sense, it's past. When we play a game, the outcome of the game becomes certain. We at that point cancel the game and begin a new one. Because the whole zest of the thing, which takes me back to the idea that this whole thing is a hide-and-seek game, is that you don't know what the next order coming up is. we have this rather myopic way of looking at things. And we screen out from attention anything that is not immediately important to a scanning system based on sensing danger. But quite obviously, you as a complete individual are much more than the scanning system. You are in relationships with the external world that on the whole are incredibly harmonious. The energies of life in the form of temperature, light, air, and food, and so on, are streaming through you all at this moment in the most magnificently harmonious way. When anything is constant, it says, okay, that's safe, it's in the bag, needn't pay attention to that anymore. And therefore, we eliminate systematically from our awareness all the gorgeous things that are going on all the time, and instead only become focused on the things, the troublesome things that might happen to upset it. Which is all right, but we make too much of it. We make so much of it that we identify our very selves, I, ego, with the radar, with the troubleshooter. And that's only a tiny fragment of one's total being. You very soon realize that your existence is not something that is just the hopeless little creature that's suddenly confronted with a great big external world that goes gah at him, you know, and eats him up. Every tiniest little thing that comes into being, every minute little fruit fly or gnat or bacterium, I will go so far as to say, is an event upon which this whole cosmos depends. This thing goes both ways. It's not only that every little organism which exists depends on its total environment. The reverse is also true, that the total environment depends on each and every one of those little organisms. So that you could say, this universe consists of an arrangement of pattern in which every event is essential to the whole thing. Now, we screen that idea out of our consciousness in exactly the same way that we screen out the perception of space as an important reality. Just as we pay attention to the figure and ignore the background, so we see one way of looking at things, namely that the organism is very frail against the environment. It lasts a long time, the environment, but the organism only lasts a short time. What do you mean the environment lasts a long time? What does the environment consist of? Just a lot of little things. When you get far enough away from all the organisms and the little bits of things, you see the environment in another scale of magnification. But actually, the whole thing is arranged in a polar system where the enormous depends on the tiny and the tiny depends on the enormous. And you get a relationship between these extremes, which can be called a transaction. They always go together. So in this way, we are always, as it were, overemphasizing a certain aspect of our experience. And we say now, what is important about people? Is their unique individuality? And we have been given an immense psychic investment in our own individuality by our upbringing. What are you going to amount to? What are you going to contribute to human life? What's your particular destiny going to be? It's a fine idea. But the thing we don't understand is that it won't work, this great idea, without being balanced with its opposite. Just as you can't have the back without the front. So you cannot have the values of a unique personality unless at the same time everybody recognizes that there is another level at which we are not unique at all, but that I am you and you are I. See, every one of you feels that you're the center of the universe and that everything else is happening around you in a circle. You can turn around and you can see sort of equally far in all directions, especially if you're in a ship in the middle of the ocean. So you're in the middle. And it's true from the standpoint of astronomy. We live in a curved space-time continuum, that is to say, in a universe at which every point may be regarded as the center. Consider a sphere. Here's a ball. What point on this ball is the center of its surface? You can see at once that any point can be the center of its surface. So legitimately, all points in the universe are the center. We are all like the nerve ends on your own skin. See, at every point on your skin, there's a little nerve end going beep and getting information from the outside world. Another and another and another, all over. And they all constitute your total sensitivity. So in the same way, when all these people sitting around here with their little eyes and little ears and things, they're going beep, and they're all really one common center called I, which is looking at itself from ever so many different points of view. Only, we are so close to it, and we are so absorbed in the different ways each one of them is doing, that we neglect the community underneath. But we don't realize, you see, that just as we know how to do this, we know equally well how to turn the sun into light, how to blue the sky, how to blow the wind, how to wave the ocean, how to digest food, and I might add, to be digested and transformed, but the pattern keeps going. And it's always you. Only you see, you have this marvelous capacity to transform yourself without knowing that you're doing it. Therefore, you keep surprising yourself. And therefore, you keep on doing it. Because if you didn't surprise yourself, you wouldn't go on doing it. It's just the very fact, you see, that you seem to be the victims of a thing you don't understand, and that you seem to conclude your life every time in a wipeout called death, where all your control goes. It's just exactly that opposite condition to what you call being alive that allows you to be alive. One of the first things which everybody should understand is that every creature in the universe that is in any way sensitive and in any manner of speaking conscious regards itself as a human being. That is to say, it knows and is aware of a hierarchy of beings above it and a hierarchy of beings below it. If you take such a tiny creature as a fruit fly, which lives only a few days, it is aware of all sorts of weird little animals and objects and spores floating in the atmosphere, which we don't even notice unless we've got a microscope around. And it criticizes them as being inferior animals and all that sort of thing. Whereas human beings are things that it doesn't comprehend. They're in as much outside its intellect as a quasar is outside ours. And we see these far-off objects floating in the heavens, and we have only the vaguest idea of what they may be. But there is, I think, a fundamental principle that everybody must understand, and that is the principle of relativity. That is to say that wherever you are, and whoever you are, and whatever you are, you're in the middle. That's the game. When you stand and you can see a horizon all around you to exactly the same distance, you're in the center of a circle because your senses extend a certain direction, in all directions, and therefore give you the impression of being in the middle. Now, everything in the world feels like that. And also it has its own kind, which look natural to it. You see, spiders and hydras and sea urchins and so on don't look very natural to us. We say, well, I wouldn't want to look like that. But they say when they see us, well, what kind of an awful thing is that? And what a lot of nonsense it does. Because the definition of a person is where you look from. And they, you see, in their situation, feel just as cultured as we can possibly feel. And they have their distinctions and their snobberies, just in the same way that we do. Because, you see, they dig all sorts of things that we don't even notice. We think a person is cultured because they play the piano or the violin or they read poetry or they have a lot of big library and they have paintings all around and they have a fancy house and so on. And we say, well, there's a person of culture. And we can see at once that this is really some rather elegant human being. But when you get down into the world of fishes, they have exactly the same thing. Only, instead of depending on collecting a lot of books and things like that, it is the precise way, the very subtle wiggles of a tail, the little tremors of vibration that makes one fish a very superior fish as compared with other fish. And all the other fish look at that one and say, oh my, to be like that, what a genius! To be able to do just that little extra thing, see? Because they're very sensitive. Even airplanes in formation can't begin to do what birds and fish can do in their communal swirling dances that they do. Here is a very strange thing. That every creature, therefore, which feels that it is human, and which knows that it's there in the same way as you know you're here, experiences being here as constituting a sort of blockage. The sensation of a certain tension which constitutes the feeling of I-ness, of there-ness, of being here. Because after all, every creature is a particular form. Everything is individual. Not only you as a total organism standing here, but all the component cells of your body, each one of them has some sort of a feeling of its own. And it is individual. You can look at a microscope at the right level of magnification, and you can see that thing there with its own little life. And if you examine the stream of your blood, you'll find it full of all kinds of organisms that are having all sorts of conspiracies and games and plots and eating each other and doing these things that like we do. Only we realize that we wouldn't be healthy as a total organism unless there were all these wars and fights and plots and politics going on between the various... in our blood. But from their point of view, you see, they feel a little bit put out. Because they're being organized. There is this sensation of a practically every living being of constituting a center of tension and of resistance. That is to say, of being a little bit blocked, or shall I say, of being in the way, being in one's own way. Imagine the opposite. Let us suppose, for example, that you got up in the morning with a feeling of total transparency. There's no resistance in your organism to the external world. You just float through it. You're part of it, it's part of you. And just in the same way, for example, that when you see, if you see well, you aren't aware of your eyes. But if there's something wrong with your eyes, and you see spots in front of you, then you are looking at your eyes, and your eyes are getting in your own way. And so, in exactly the same way, the perfect form of man is unaware of himself, because he doesn't get in his own way. He is thus, in this sense, completely transparent.